I'm wondering how you and your party plans to sort of find the balance between tough on crime initiatives and the realities that face in more impoverished communities and the crime rates within those communities. What kind of balance can be struck, especially in relation to the new, to the more recent sort of, what are they called? The more recent initiatives, the more recent proposals by the Conservative government that have been proposed.
I just want to first, I wish I could ask you a question right back. What I'd like to ask you is, what kind of crime are we talking about here? We really need to define that in order for me to better answer the question. But what I would like to say is, in impoverished communities, maybe some of the crimes are happening because there is so much poverty. And one thing that we need to do is begin to phase out poverty completely. We need to bridge the gap between the rich and the poor in this country. And one of the ways that we are going to do that, if elected, is we would cut income tax on anyone who is making $20,000 or less. They don't need to be paying any extra taxes because they can't afford it. So hopefully that would, you know, offset a little bit of the crime. I mean, I was in the grocery store the other day and I saw this poor man being followed out of the grocery store because he walked out with a loaf of bread. And I thought to myself, man, this is happening right here in my own city, and that's not right. Another thing we'd like to do is introduce, you know, community gardens and initiatives that would help bring more options to our local food banks. And, you know, people are happier and healthier when they eat right.
Ramon, thank you for the question. I'll tell you what I don't agree with. I don't agree with U.S.-style mega prisons that are going to cost billions and billions of dollars, unless, of course, we're looking to put some of the conservatives who have broken the law in those jail cells. But otherwise, we don't need them. The crime rate has been dropping consistently in Canada over many, many years. This is simply fear-mongering. We don't need mega prisons, U.S.-style mega prisons. We do not need them. We do not need to spend that kind of money on them. What we do need is to engage young people. We need them to feel like they're part of their community. And how we do that is with offering up great education, great programs to young people. We have a guy here in town whose name is John Elliott, and he's with the Sandwich Teen Action Group out in the West End of Windsor, and he is doing amazing things. He has a center there where young people can come and hang out, they can play pool, they can talk to each other, there are learning programs available to them, and that's keeping these kids off the streets and out of trouble, out of harm's way. They're not getting in with bad groups that might cause them to maybe do something they'll regret later. We need to engage our young people. The Liberal platform also has a program where if young people volunteer, well, we're going to give you a little tax credit for that. We're going to give you a little something for volunteering, and I think that's great.
The idea of social problems in the community are real. They are linked to people having, for example, a culture that's based on violence sometimes as the method of choice for sorting out problems. If you have a country that's very quick to go abroad and train youth to kill other people because the foreign policy dictates you're on this side and you're going to go and help the U.S. in this case carry out its project to dominate the whole planet, then it's, you know, it's not so surprising that people see that violence and guns and that kind of thing are a so-called solution. So things have to be looked at in their context. Now, for sure there is social crime and it is a problem, but I think if you look at it, there's a disproportionate number of people who come from certain communities, like First Nations are represented way beyond the proportions that they should be in the prisons as it is. Working class and poor youth, those who have a poor low education, sure, they should be provided with opportunities, and the society that had a healthy culture and good opportunities for everyone would probably find a lot less social crime of the kind that is a concern to our neighborhoods and our communities.
Thanks, Ramon. Actually, that's a critical question for our youth in particular, but also many of us, and when we're looking forward to having individuals that are going to go forward and make the right choices. As a former employment specialist for youth at risk, I can tell you that if they had opportunity and hope, they made better decisions. And sometimes, you know, people do make bad decisions and doesn't excuse them for that behavior, but we need to create that opportunity and hope. And having a high unemployment rate among youth in Windsor and Essex County is bad. That's 20%. 6%. So I recently did an initiative with a number of different youth groups that called on businesses to set aside money and to cut their budgets the best that they can to find the money to hire students this summer. That's a critical thing to get going. And there's a balance out there between crime and punishment. There's no doubt that those that commit crimes against other Canadians, whether it be in our community or other places in Canada, should be punished for that behavior, and it should be noted. But at the same time, we have to make sure there's balance. And the balance is that we have to make sure there's crime prevention strategies, be it education, be it in the schools, be in the programs that are out there to help people either get back to school or go to work and find employment. So there's a number of different tactics to take at this. I think it's important to recognize the balance, though.